This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at Sierra College and author of Managerial Accounting. This video describes how to take a look at production constraints and to minimize the impact of those limited resources that we might have. Many companies have limited resources, and when we talk about resources, we really mean labor hours, machine hours, could be facilities, could be materials. There are constraints out there. There are limited resources, and we have to manage those. So we're going to talk here about how best to analyze and manage constraints. There are five steps associated with managing constraints. We're going to be taking a look at those in summary form here and in detail in the following slides. The first, and oh, by the way, this is called the theory of constraints. That's a term that's often used. The first step is to find the bottleneck. Where is the bottleneck? Where do we have that constraint? And then the second step is to optimize the use of whatever that constraint is. And we'll talk about how to do that next. And then step three, we're going to subordinate all non-bottleneck resources, that is, move them from those areas where we don't have any bottlenecks over to where we do have the bottleneck. And then step four is to increase the bottleneck's efficiency, wherever that limited resource is. Let's try to maximize the efficiency in that area. And then go back and find the bottleneck again. There are going to be other bottlenecks out there. So we go back to step one and repeat these steps. Here's an example of how best to manage constraints. Our company is called, in this example, Computers Inc. And let's assume that we make three different models. We make a desktop computer, and we call that model A100. And so we assemble that in department one. We also make a laptop computer, and we call that model model P120. And then we also assemble and produce and assemble tablets, and we call that model S150. So those are three different departments that we have, and as these different products are produced, they're assembled, they are then forwarded over to the department for quality testing area. And as we'll see on the next slide, this is going to be where we have a problem with our resources. There's a bottleneck here, and it's slowing up getting our products out the door to Department 5 in terms of packaging and out the door in terms of shipping. So we're going to be focusing on this area right here, this Department 4 quality testing, and trying to figure out how to make it more efficient. All right, for step one for Computers Inc., we need to find the bottleneck, and I've already identified it in the previous slide. The bottleneck is with our quality testing area, and the main reason we have a bottleneck there, because there can be lots of different reasons that it's a bottleneck, but the main reason that we're going to assume is because we have a shortage of labor hours to perform the testing. So it's not a shortage in terms of the equipment that we use for the testing or the space that we use for the testing. The bottleneck is with labor hours in this example. So once we've identified that, we're going to go to step two and try to optimize the use of the constrained resource that we've identified. So we're going to try to optimize then the use of our direct labor hours, and we'll talk about how best to do that on the next slide. Since labor hours is our constraint in the quality testing department, we're going to figure out the contribution margin per labor hour for each product that we produce. And I have a separate video on how to do this, but you can see it here as well. What we do is figure out the contribution margin per unit for each product, and you can see it's $100 for the A100 model, and it's $250 for P120, and then it's $240 for the tablet model, the S150. And then we take the contribution margin per unit and divide it by the labor hours required to produce each model. And it's less than an hour, so that's why you see the decimal format here. And that gives us then the contribution margin per labor hour. So you'll see here that it's $500 for the A100 model, $625 for the P120 model, and $800 per labor hour for the S150 model. So this is one way to look at it. We're basically saying that the most profitable model per constrained resource per labor hour is the S150 model. That doesn't mean we're just going to make the S150 model at the expense of all the other models, but instead it just helps us to realize where our resources are best placed. But really, ideally, we'd like to alleviate this bottleneck by getting more labor hours or making more labor hours available to this department. So we'll talk further about that in the next slide. Step three in our example here, and in terms of our theory of constraints, is to subordinate all non-bottleneck resources to the bottleneck. In other words, if we can find labor from other areas, and you can see this in step four, and train those personnel to be able to perform quality testing, then that will help to alleviate the bottleneck that we've identified in the quality testing area. So step four is to increase the bottleneck's efficiency and capacity. So we're trying to bring over other employees, or maybe make the current employees that are in that department more efficient by training those employees. And then hopefully that will help to alleviate the bottleneck in the quality testing area. And as we mentioned before, step five is to start over again. Normally, when we take care of one bottleneck, bottlenecks may pop up elsewhere. Maybe we have a problem shipping the product or a problem with assembly in one of the departments. And so we go back and try to identify where the bottleneck is now and go through the same process, steps one through four.